Thank you for having me. And if we have any questions along the way, feel free to ask. Tonight, we're talking about the key role nutrition plays in exercise, which is a great topic that Fernando has asked me to present tonight. Getting proper foods and supplements into your system and at the right times can really, really help enhance your workout, your exercise regime or exercise program, and ultimately improve your overall health. Sport and exercise nutrition is really, really highly specialized. There's a lot of variables involved with sport and nutrition, and it really depends on the types of exercises or sports that you're involved with, what level you're at, the intensity level, as well as your pre-existing health status and what your goals are. So it's impossible for me to go over all of the variables in this one session tonight. So what Fernando has asked me to do in the next little while is to give you a really good overview of what you need to eat before and after your exercise to maximize your workout, okay? So tonight, what we're going to be doing is looking at, first and foremost, your digestive system. And the reason this is so important is because it really is the foundation of good health. If your digestive system isn't working well, no matter how much you work out, what you're eating, you're not going to get the maximum benefit of your fitness program. And if any of you have seen me speak before, you know I really am really key on having a really good digestive system running before we approach anything else. So that's the first thing we're going to talk about tonight. And then I'm going to talk about the two main exercise types, the activities that people are involved with spinal cord injuries. The first one is cardio exercise. So we're going to look at that and the foods you can eat before and after to help you, as well as strength training, weight training, and the foods you need to eat before and after to really maximize your workout program. And then the last thing I would like to talk about is your joint health. We put a lot of extra stress on our systems, on our bodies, on our shoulders, and on our arms, just day-to-day living and activities. And then if you add on top of that cardio exercises or weight exercises, you're putting more stress on it. So it's also really important to take care of your joints and make sure that they're in good shape. So we're going to talk about foods and supplements to also maintain and protect your joints' health. Okay, so to get started, we are going to talk about the digestive system, and this is a crucial body system. There are three components to your digestive health. It's digestion, so breaking down your foods, then absorption, absorbing all those great nutrients from the good foods that you've been eating, and also elimination. Okay, so those are the three things that we're going to talk about briefly, and if you have these working really well, then you can work out well, and we'll get into your other body systems. Okay, so there are two steps to optimal digestion and absorption. First thing that you want to do as far as your digestive system goes, when you've had a spinal cord injury, your peristalsis has been limited. It's been affected. Your peristalsis is the muscular contraction that helps propel your food through your digestive tract. When you've had a spinal cord injury, this is significantly slowed down, which means you're automatically going to have your digestive system affected. So we do need to enhance this as much as possible. So the first thing you can do to enhance your digestive system, your absorption function, is to ensure you have optimal enzyme and stomach acid levels. Okay, so what I mean by this, for those of you who are not familiar, your digestive enzymes are little proteins. They're also known as the sparks of life because they are what help break down your food, your fats, your carbohydrates, and your proteins into small, tiny pieces so that they can be absorbed into your bloodstream and then feed your cells. So if you are not having good digestive enzyme output, and if you are not having these work effectively, you're not going to break down your food effectively. Stomach acid, also produced in the lining of your stomach, are responsible for breaking down your proteins as well as your minerals. And again, if you're not secreting enough stomach acid, it's also going to affect your overall digestive system. And if you're not having enough stomach acid secreted, it can lead to malnutrition of essential proteins and essential minerals. Now, there are a couple of things that can affect low stomach enzyme activity and low stomach acid production, and that is stress. When you're living with a spinal cord injury, you naturally have some kind of stress, whether it's emotional stress, mental stress, or even physical stress in the form of pain. Stress decreases your stomach acid production. It also decreases the effectiveness of how your digestive enzymes work. Signs of low enzyme and stomach acid production are a lot of gas, a lot of bloating, feeling tired after you eat, just discomfort or burning pain, or even if you look on your fingernails, if you have little white dots, that's a sign that you're not breaking down your food properly and absorbing it properly. And a lot of people with spinal cord injuries who never had digestive issues before their injury, suddenly after injury are having a lot of these kinds of issues. So if you are having any chronic gas, bloating, indigestive issues, there are some great things that you can do to help enhance it. And that is to eat more foods that are actually rich in natural enzymes. Fresh fruits and vegetables are rich in natural enzymes. You want to eat them raw as much as possible, because when you actually heat a lot of fruits and vegetables, you kill the natural enzyme activity. So eat them raw. Some really great foods that are high in enzymes are things like pineapple, avocado, banana, and papaya. You can also get stomach acid and enzyme supplements, which you can buy from a natural food, health food store. Okay, so you just take one or two of these digestive enzymes every meal, and you'd be amazed how they can actually help your digestive function, decrease gas, decrease bloating, decrease any kind of heartburn situation. The other thing you might want to do to ensure that you're having good stomach acid production is to decrease or at least limit things like red meat, dairy. There are a lot of refined processed foods and carbonated drinks. All of these things also decrease your stomach acid production. So those are some things you can do. Eat lots more raw fruits and vegetables, maybe get some digestive enzymes, and just eat less red meat, dairy, processed foods, carbonated drinks. Okay. The next thing you might want to do to increase your digestive function is to drink plenty of water. I know you guys know how important water is for flushing the bladder, keeping yourself hydrated. If you've been through rehabilitation, we all have heard you've got to drink lots and lots of water. But drinking lots of water is also really important, because the more hydrated you are, the more stomach acid you will produce. Also, the more hydrated you are, the more your digestive enzymes will work more efficiently. And also, once you've got all those great nutrients running through your system, the more hydrated you are, the more water you have in your system, it's going to help carry all those great nutrients through your body. Also, get rid of the toxins that you're running through your system, and contribute to less issues of constipation. You want to get about 6 to 8 cups of water a day. On average, most people are only getting about 4 cups. So most people out there rolling around, walking around, are dehydrated. So you're aiming for 6 to 8 cups of water a day. Okay, so those are the simple things you can do to increase your digestive function. And drinking more water leads me to the third important digestive function that many people with spinal cord injuries have trouble with, and that is elimination, the elimination function. Okay, so it's really, really important to ensure that you are getting your foods eliminated in a timely manner, because if you're not, then what you're doing is building up toxins in your system. Toxins are really detrimental to both your physical and mental health. If you're not getting rid of your toxins, it's going to affect your physical performance, your workout program, absolutely. But it's also going to build up carcinogens in your system. When your waste matter sits in your gut, in your bowel for too long, carcinogens, toxins form, they get reabsorbed into your bloodstream. They have to then travel through your bloodstream and then get refiltered through your liver. So you're putting more stress also on your liver. So you're basically just causing a lot more stress on your system, which is going to make it more tired. You're going to be zapping your energy. The other thing is when toxins are reabsorbed into your blood and they're floating through your system, they're going to affect your mind, your health, and your clarity of your thinking. When toxins build up, they can really give you that kind of foggy, loogie head that you also can often have. You might have a great night's sleep, a good 6 to 8 hours, but often you wake up and you're still, you just can't snap at it. It could be that there's too many toxins floating through your system. And if you're just feeling really awful, then you're, again, it's going to affect your workout performance. So you want to make sure that you are getting those toxins out of your system so you're having a better workout program, but it's also going to have a more positive effect on your day-to-day activity, how you're just socializing, working, whatever it is that you want to do. So two really easy and important steps to help increase your bowel function is to increase fiber. And I know you guys have all heard of this, but it really is truly critical. What you are aiming for, specifically, people with spinal cord injuries need 15 to 30 grams of fiber a day. So how can you get that? Where do you get fiber from? Fruits, vegetables, whole grains, legumes, things like beans and peas. That's where you're going to get a lot of fiber in your diet from. And what we're looking at, ideal servings, every day, if you can get a minimum of 5 servings of vegetables, 1 to 2 servings of fruits, 2 servings of legumes, and 1 to 2 servings of whole grains. And when I say a serving, what you're looking for is about a handful. Okay, so just think of it the size of a baseball or a handful. That is a serving, okay? So that is what you are looking for every day to ensure you're getting that 15 to 30 grams of fiber in your diet every day. I'm sure you have better bowel function. It's recommended that able-bodied people have 1 to 3 bowel movements a day. Okay. Now for us, given that we evacuate our bowels differently, we don't want to be having 1 to 3 a day or we'd be sitting in the bathroom all day with our bowel programs. But what you're looking to do then is at least once a day. And if you're not having a bowel routine once a day, then at least every other day. Okay. That's what you're looking for. The next thing you want to do to ensure good elimination is to ensure that you have good levels of good friendly bacteria in your system. Good bacteria help actually break down your food even more and propel waste matter through your system. We have at any time 400 to 500 different types of good bacteria in our guts, and we need them. They weigh about 2 to 3 pounds of our total body weight, and it's really important for helping things move through your system. Where do you get good bacteria? We get them through fermented foods. So things like yogurt or kefir, any kind of fermented sauerkraut, things like that. Or you can get them through probiotic supplements, which again, you can easily get from a health food store. And what you're looking for is about a minimum of 8 billion active microorganisms per capsule. If you can take one at night before you go to bed, it's the best time to take them on an empty stomach before you go to bed. It'll just ensure that your gut is filled up with good bacteria, so you're going to the bathroom more. And the beautiful thing about probiotic supplements is they also help improve your immune system. They really do help boost your immune system. So it's great just every day to take, just to ensure and prevent yourself from getting any kind of, you know, infection or flu or cold or anything like that. Okay, so that is what you're looking at for good digestion. Really, really, truly important overall health and for fitness. So now what we want to do, moving into the fitness segment here, now that your digestive system is working really, really well, we are going to look at different energy systems for different types of working out. Okay, there are 3 main macronutrients that provide energy for working out. The 3 main macronutrients are things like carbohydrates, so things like whole grain pasta, whole grain breads, brown rice. Proteins are also a nice energy source. things like meat. So whether it be beef, chicken, turkey, eggs, even nuts and seeds are great protein sources. Also really important, good fats in foods like fish. You can get good fats also in nuts, avocados. Those are your three main energy sources. Now, which ones you use will depend on the type, the duration, and the intensity of the exercise that you're doing. And we're going to go through these now. We're going to start with cardiovascular exercise. So for people who like to either race their chair, intense wheeling through the park, maybe you've got an arm bike, maybe you like to do swimming, these are the kind of cardiovascular exercise that we're going to be talking about right now. For cardiovascular exercise, your body's preferred energy source are carbohydrates, okay? When you're working out intensely, and we're talking about, you know, really kind of working up a sweat, really working hard, pushing hard, for 3 minutes or more, that is when you're using your carbohydrates as your main fuel source, okay? Now, when you need carbohydrates to make glycogen. Does everybody know what glycogen is? Glycogen is your body's stored form of glucose. And glucose comes from carbohydrates. When you eat any kind of carbohydrate, whether it be sugar from the table, whether it be a piece of bread, whether it be pasta, or whether it be some brown rice, carbohydrates, once they are digested in our system, are all broken down into glucose. And our body can actually store glucose, and it's called glycogen. And glycogen, the stored form of glucose, is stored in our liver, and it's stored also in our muscles. Okay, so I hope that's clear to everybody, because I can't hear you back to see if you have any questions for me quite yet. The other thing that's really, really important for you to do is to drink lots. If you're doing lots of good cardio exercises, you must remain hydrated. Lots and lots of fluids, and we're going to go through good forms of healthy fluids as well. Okay, so what does this actually mean? What should you be eating to fulfill your energy source if you prefer to do a lot of good cardio workouts? Okay, so I've just got a chart there for you. The proportion of macronutrients used in hardcore cardio workout. I think this is kind of interesting to see. If you're working out really, really intensely and you're going wheeling, you've got an arm bike going, for 5 to 10 minutes or more, your body is using 65% carbohydrates as a fuel source, 30% of fats, and 5% protein, okay? So you can see, if you're working out really hard, good cardio workout, you can see you need to eat a lot of carbs. If you are eating a lot of protein and not getting enough carbs, you're actually going to kill your performance. Not only can you kill your cardio performance if you're not eating enough carbs, you can also lead to muscle breakdown. Our bodies can turn protein into an energy source, but if you're not giving yourself enough carbs to maintain your energy, your body's going to turn to its own muscle for an energy source. So it can actually lead to breakdown of your own muscle. This is why it's really important to make sure you're getting a lot of carbs into your diet, both pre and post workout. Okay, so just move up here. Any questions so far, you guys? Any questions, Fernando? Store glucose. It's the main fuel for our brains, for our entire workout here. As an interesting point, your liver stores about 87 to 100 grams of glycogen, glucose, and your muscles store about 350. People with spinal cord injuries probably store a little less because we tend to have muscle atrophy. If you don't have enough glucose in your system through carbohydrates, your muscles are going to start performing, but you're also going to have mental fatigue because carbohydrates are your brain's preferred energy source as well. So it's really important to be getting lots of carbs into your diet. Okay, so go. Another really interesting point that I wanted to put in here about what happens to your body when you're working out is there's two hormones that are involved with your blood sugar, blood glucose levels, and those are adrenaline and cortisol. Okay, when you're working out really, really, really hard, it's a form of stress on your body, good stress, and there are stress hormones, cortisol and adrenaline. And what's really interesting is your body, when it produces adrenaline, it causes your liver to break down that glycogen, that stored form of glucose in your liver, which is interesting. So you're working out hard, your body needs a lot of energy. Adrenaline's pumped out, it makes your liver actually release that glucose from your liver. The other thing that cortisol does, which is really interesting, is it actually promotes protein catabolism. Protein catabolism is actually the breakdown of muscle in your body. That's what happens when you're working out really hard in a cardio workout. So what's interesting is cortisol and adrenaline, they're released during exercise, but they actually, after exercise, when you eat carbohydrates, you stop the production of adrenaline and cortisol, which is why, as we'll get into soon, you need to eat carbs before your workout to keep yourself the energy, but you also need to eat them afterwards to stop the cortisol from being produced so your muscles won't be broken down and so that you're replenishing your glycogen stores. Okay. Any questions on this? The other thing I wanted to provide for you guys is to go through glycemic index. It's important to know not just when to be eating your carbs, but what kind. There are different kinds of carbohydrates. And I'm not sure if everybody's familiar with a glycemic index. The glycemic index is a system and it refers to how quickly carbohydrate foods are converted into blood sugar. And basically what they've done is taken a bunch of different carbohydrate foods and they test them. You eat them and then 2 hours later test blood to see how quickly or slowly they raise your blood sugar. And this is really important too, as we'll get to, you'll see soon. There are different types, low and medium glycemic index and carbohydrates, and there's high glycemic index carbohydrates. Okay, so what I have done, show you on the next chart here. We go. I've listed for you here foods that are high and low on the glycemic index so you can know which ones to eat. Okay, so complex carbohydrate foods, things like whole grains, sweet potatoes have more fiber in them. So these are digested very slowly and they don't raise your blood sugar levels very quickly. Okay, these are considered low to medium glycemic index carbohydrates. Simple carbohydrates, which I'm sure we've all heard about, are things like pop, cookies, candies, pastries. They are actually broken down very, very quickly because there's no fiber in them and they raise blood sugar very quickly. These are high glycemic, okay? So that's what you can see here on the chart. You can see on your screen. Okay, sugar, glycemic index is rated on a scale of 1 to 100. Sugar is rated 100. So you can see all the foods and their numbers there and how they contribute, where they fit into the glycemic index, which ones are high and which ones are low. And knowing the glycemic index of foods is really important because delivering the right ones and the right amount at the right time will help you optimize your workout. It will help improve glycogen stores and it will also help deliver more nutrients and more fuel to your brain to improve your cardio workout. Okay, so that's a lot of background about carbohydrates, different kinds, what they do. Let's get down to the good stuff here. Basically, what do you need to do to enhance your performance? Carbohydrate intake before exercise, during, and after. Okay, so you want to make sure you're getting the right kind of carbs at the right time before you work out to help prevent fatigue, saturate those glycogen stores in your liver, in your muscles. And what do you need to do this? You need to eat moderate to low complex carbohydrates, approximately 30 grams of them 1 hour before your cardio exercise. Okay, there has to be some fiber in there to slow the digestion and balance your blood sugar levels. So before, if you know you're having a really good hard cardio workout, about 30 to 60 minutes before, eat about 30 grams of good carbohydrates, complex carbohydrates, low to moderate ones before you're working out. Now, if you are working out intensely, if you're, say, going for a hand cycle ride for 90 minutes or longer, then you're going to want to replenish your energy stores during that kind of workout. And if that's the case, to sustain your energy levels and prevent a drop in your blood glucose levels, what you want to do is eat a high glycemic carb or drink a high glycemic gel or drink during that high intense workout if it's 90 minutes or longer, okay? And there are some specific carbohydrate drinks and gels that you can consume during a really hard cardio workout. After a good cardio workout, you want to make sure also you're getting carbohydrates to replace your muscle and liver glycogen stores. If you've been working out pretty hard, you're going to deplete the glycogen stores in your muscle, in your liver. So you want to replenish those. You also, remember, want to drop your cortisol levels, that hormone, so you're not breaking down muscle. Okay? So what's really interesting is after you've had a really good cardio workout, your body basically acts like a sponge. So after your workout, you want to eat high glycemic carbohydrates. So before you want to eat the low to moderate ones, now you want to be eating the high ones, and you want to eat about 50 to 70 grams, 30 to 60 minutes post-workout. The sooner you can eat these high glycemic carbohydrates after working out, the more responsive your body is at replenishing those glycogen stores. So you've got about a 2-hour window after a really good cardio workout to replace it with high glycemic index carbs. After about 2 hours, you've kind of lost that window. So look on that list of foods I gave you for the high and low ones so you'll know which ones to eat before, during, and after a good cardio workout. Okay. Any questions? Any questions from anybody? Fernando? Okay. So I've given you some healthy carb foods here, just a quick list that you could eat before or after you're working out. Things like whole grain breads, whole grain muffins, or whole grain toast. Oatmeal is wonderful. Things like bananas, lots of fiber in there would be great. You could have any of those kind of things before or after. They're inexpensive. There are also on the market, I'm sure you've seen, some energy bars. Some are good, some are bad. So what I wanted to do for you guys too is also give you some healthier choices. Really good energy bars, things like Cliff and Luna are organic, they're healthier ingredients, and they'll give you the good energy source that you need. When I was talking about high-intensity cardio workouts for 90 minutes or more, when you want to have replace some glycogen stores, keep your energy going, some really good energy gels, energy drinks that you can get on the market, I've listed here, things like Excel, Cliff Shot, Gulp and Go, there's one called Goo, another one called Hammer Gel. These are all really good choices for you if you're having a really good hard workout, and you can just drink them quickly down and replenish your energy stores. Okay, so those are some of the foods that you want to be consuming for cardio. At the beginning, I was saying the other big thing you want to do for good hard cardio workouts, besides good carbohydrates, is to make sure you are well hydrated. And this is really critical to good cardio exercise. Water is the main component of blood to carry those nutrients around. It carries oxygen, it carries the hormones, the adrenaline, the cortisol I was talking about. It also helps regulate your body temperature, which is so crucial for anybody with a spinal cord injury, because our body temperatures tend to be altered, so it can be actually quite dangerous for us if our body temperature gets too high and kind of gets out of whack. So we really want to make sure we're well hydrated for that reason. The other thing is people with spinal cord injuries tend to be more dehydrated. because of the medications we're on, diuretics, also laxatives for bowel routines, we tend to be more dehydrated. So it's really, really critical that you remain hydrated. So I've also listed here what you want to do in terms of how much to drink and when to drink before, during, and after a good cardio workout. So before working out, what you want to do about 12 to 14 hours before is drink about 2.5 to 3 liters of water or fluids beforehand. Really, really critical, because when you're working out, you can sweat out liters of fluids. And the problem with this, if you're sweating out too much and not replenishing it, is you can lose electrolytes, okay? Electrolytes are minerals, things like sodium and potassium. And you want to make sure that your sodium potassium levels are maintained, or it can really affect your health and be quite dangerous. So what you want to do is drink lots of good electrolyte-friendly drinks when you're working out. And I'm going to get into those in a second. So before working out your cardio workout, 90 to 60 minutes of intense cardio workout, 2 to 5 liters, 3 liters, and then about an hour to an hour and a half before you start your workout, drink 500 milliliters, so one of those little bottles of water, okay? So that should keep you well hydrated if you're working out really, really hard. And during an intense workout, again, if you're going 90 minutes or more, you want to be sipping about 250 milliliters every 15 to 20 minutes. Or again, get those high glycemic index gels, okay? Any of the ones listed there, you can drink those. They won't cause stomach upset, and they'll be really great for keeping you hydrated, but also get those, your carbohydrate, glycogen, glucose stores up. After exercise, again, your body is like a sponge. Immediately after a really hard cardio workout, you want to be drinking 500 milliliters of water, okay? If you are looking to replace electrolytes, as we all know on the market, there's a lot of sport drinks which have electrolytes in them. The unfortunate thing is a lot of these have unnatural colorings, artificial flavors. You want to keep it as clean as possible. Artificial flavors, artificial colorings are actually neurotoxins. They're very irritating to the nervous system. When you've had a spinal cord injury, you want to reduce any kind of irritation in your system. So drinking water would be great. But instead of having a sport drink, one of the best natural electrolyte drinks that you can get out there is coconut water. Coconut water has lots of sodium, lots of potassium, but what's amazing is coconut water, the electrolyte balance in that actually matches our blood electrolyte balance perfectly. And a really interesting point is back in World War II in the Pacific, what they would do is if they didn't have any kind of transfusions, any plasma transfusions, they could actually just stream coconut water directly intravenously into your bloodstream without having a negative reaction, because it does match your blood plasma levels perfectly. So drinking coconut water after a really good hard cardio workout is a great, natural, healthy way to replace your electrolyte balances. The beautiful thing is it's also really nutritious. It's got less fat than milk. It's got no cholesterol. It's got less calories than drinking juice. It's got more potassium than most sport drinks on the market. It's got less sodium. And it's got natural sugars as opposed to a lot of extra sugars, processed sugars that you'll find in a lot of these sport drinks. I did list here, though, just in case some people don't like coconut water, I did list some of the healthier sport drinks that there are on the market. Or I can also say to my clients a lot of times, drink whatever tastes good to you, because you do need to hydrate. So if you don't like any of these things, then drink what you do like, just to make sure you are hydrating really, really well. Okay, so that is, there we go. Oh, the booze. I want to talk a little bit about this. This is really interesting. I'm sure we've all done it. A lot of people, after a really good workout, got, you know, good team sport, good cardio workout, you go out and have a drink afterwards. And it's actually quite funny, because people often say, well, you know, beer, for example, which seems to be the one of choice, often has a lot of carbohydrates in it. So you're replenishing your glycogen stores. So isn't that a good thing? You know, I'm getting lots of fluid. But actually, it's not, okay? And here's why. When you are drinking any kind of alcoholic drink afterwards, as I was saying, your body acts like a sponge after a really good hard cardio workout. You're going to get drunker faster, which is not really a benefit of working out if you want to optimize your workout. The thing is, though, it's going to dehydrate you. You might be getting drunk faster and the effects of it, but it's actually a diuretic. You're going to be sucking more fluid from your system. The other thing is it tends to make you hungrier, so then you're going to be wanting more calories. You're probably reaching for some food afterwards, which will kind of diminish the effects of the working out that you've just done. So it's actually not the best thing to be drinking after a workout. It can also affect your body temperature. And as I was saying, we're already affected because of our spinal cord injury and our body temperature. So you don't really want to be messing with that post-workout. So it's really not something you want to be hydrating with. So try and avoid drinking alcohol after a workout. It's not the right kind of carbohydrates you want to be having to replenish those glycogen stores, okay? So there's lots of information there that we've just gone over with regards to cardio workout of any kind, but really with the slides I've presented there, if you can just focus in on those key ones there about how many carbs to be eating and when to be eating them before, during, and after working out, that's what's really important. I've given you a lot of background information to the glycemic index, but it's really just to help you understand how your body works, how your system works, and how different foods affect your system pre, during, and post workout. But really, with what we've covered there, just look at that one slide that has before, during, and after, if you really just want it in a nutshell, what you should be doing, okay? So we're going to be moving on to the second biggest form of working out people's spinal cord injuries, and that is weight training, strength training. And this is big for us, you know, to keep our upper body as strong as possible so we can be wheeling, transferring, and doing everything we need to do to maintain our everyday function. So with weights, the main and preferred fuel source here is protein. With cardio, it was carbohydrates. With working out with weights, it's protein. When you're doing strengthening exercises of any kind, you need protein to help repair and build muscle that you're breaking down. It is protein that our body uses to make collagen, and it's collagen which makes our skin, makes our muscle, everything. So you need to be replenishing your system with protein. Different proteins have different levels of what's called biological availability to the human body. One method of measuring protein utilization is called the biological value, okay? Biological value examines which proteins the body uses most efficiently, okay? And the most efficient ones have the higher biological value. So I've given you those here, right there. So as you can see, number one is whey protein. It has the highest biological value for us, and this is what I highly recommend if you're doing a lot of strength training. Whey protein is amazing to help your body build and repair more muscle. What's interesting is human breast milk has a biological value of 95. Whey protein has 104, human milk has 95. Not that we're going to be drinking human milk, but you can just see how efficient that is for feeding babies and just how they need the most nutrients at that time in their lives to grow the biggest, the strongest. So it's quite interesting that human milk has a biological value of 95. Eggs have a biological value of 94, cheese 84, fish 76, beef 74. So you can see of all of these, you know, you don't need to be chowing down a big steak or eating tons of eggs before you can work out. One of the best things you can do is have whey protein, okay? And we're going to be talking quite a bit about whey protein. Whey protein is critical for developing and sustaining new muscle mass. The beautiful thing is it's also digested really rapidly, so it's increasing the refueling speed of your muscles during the critical time just following a workout. So we're going to be talking a lot about whey protein. Okay. All right, so here we go. For strength training, what you need to be looking at in terms of consuming protein before and after exercise. Okay, a recent study published in the Journal of Medical Science of Sports and Exercise demonstrated that consuming 20 to 30 grams of whey protein with no sugar added 30 minutes before resistance training boosts your body's metabolism for as much as 24 hours after your workout. So you want to be looking at getting 20 to 30 grams of protein about 30 minutes before you are weight training. After your workout, again, if you can consume 20 to 30 grams of whey protein 30 to 60 minutes after working out to not only increase your fat burning, but also increase your muscle building. Now, a lot of people do not want to be consuming protein both pre and post workout. Studies show that if you're going to do either of these, then you want to look at having the 20 to 30 grams of protein after the workout. That's the more important one. Absolutely, if you're training hard, doing a lot of weightlifting, you can do both. But if you don't want to do both, then look at getting the protein after your workout. That's going to give you the best benefit. Okay. So we're looking at, in terms of 20 to 30 grams of protein, what does that mean? I've given you a chart here that lists different types of proteins, the amounts, and how many grams of protein are in there so that you know if you don't want to have any whey protein, other sources of protein that you can eat to get that 20 to 30 grams. Or if you want to, what you can do is get whey protein. Most whey proteins, one scoop is about 25 grams of protein. So you can drink it. It's the fastest, easiest, most effective way to get a lot of carbs in, to get a lot of protein, sorry, in you. You can see when looking at the other list of proteins there that you'd have to eat quite a bit of them to get the 20 to 30 grams. But the fastest, simplest way to do it is to drink it in a whey protein powder, which you can just mix with some water or maybe mix with some almond milk and just drink that before and or after your workout. I've listed here some good whey protein brands. IsoWhey from Interactive Nutrition is a great one. Low Carb IsoWhey by Precision Nutrition, IsoFlex by Almax, or WhayMax by PVL. You can pretty much buy these in most health food stores across the country. You can ask for them, and again, one scoop is going to give you that 20, 25 grams of protein that you need. Now, there are, as we all know, a lot of protein bars on the market, but you really don't want to be eating a lot of these. Most of them are filled with a lot of corn syrup, artificial flavors, fillers, sugars, preservatives. They're really not the best thing for you. So it's really best to get your protein sources from the whey or from the list of proteins that I listed for you in that chart. Okay, so I'm not sure if we're having any questions here, if any questions have come up for me so far. Okay, so far no. Okay, I do want to talk about the importance of good fats for both cardio and weight workouts. Good fats are really critical for any kind of working out, whether you're doing cardio and or weights. The reason for that is that good fats actually help deliver oxygen and other nutrients to your muscles. They're also really important for increasing aerobic metabolism, which is needed particularly in cardio exercise.
Hey, Joanne, can you hear
me? And what's really, really crucial is that good fats help reduce inflammation in tissues and muscles after working out. So they actually help speed the recovery after weight training, which is really, really important. Now, good fats are absolutely critical. Good fats found in things like fish, nuts, seeds, avocados are really important to help deliver nutrients, oxygen. They help your cells work better. They increase your metabolism. What's also really critical is they help reduce inflammation in your tissues and muscles, therefore help speed the recovery after weight training. So some really great ideas to get good fats into your diet and improve your workout: eating fish 3 to 4 times a week, eating olive oil, almonds, walnuts, or if you don't like fish or you know you just generally don't eat enough fish in your diet 3 to 4 times a week, one of the best things you can do is consume fish oils. 2 to 4 capsules of fish oils every single day, particularly of omega-3 fatty acids. The omega-3 fish oils are really, really great for reducing inflammation in your system. The other side benefit of getting lots of good fats in your system is they're great for your cardiovascular health, great for your nerve health, also really great for your elimination and for bowel function. So it's also really, really important. So good fats are also really critical to both cardio and muscle workouts. Okay, so that is my talk on foods, how much, what kind you should be focusing on pre, during, and post for cardio and muscle training. As I was saying at the beginning, I do also want to talk about joint health. Joint health is so important for us because we do tend to put so much extra strain on our shoulders, on our wrists, whether you're using crutches or a wheelchair. And if you are working out, you're just putting more stress on them. So it really is truly critical that we take care of our joints with foods, with supplements. The usual treatment for joint health, if you have any kind of issues with inflammation, arthritis, tendonitis, is to take anti-inflammatories, things like ibuprofen or Advil. The problem with these types of medications is that they just tend to mask the pain of inflammation. They don't actually do anything to regenerate the cartilage, the bones, or the tissue. And in fact, if you take a lot of these, they may be causing more damage to your system because suddenly you don't feel the pain and you might be pushing your joints beyond your pain threshold. And what's also really important to know is a lot of these anti-inflammatories actually inhibit collagen repair. If you have been damaging your joints from overuse, your body wants to repair it naturally. But if you're taking a lot of these anti-inflammatories on a long-term basis, you're inhibiting your collagen repair. The other thing is there are side effects. These are really hard on your stomach, and they're also really hard on your liver. And the newest research shows that the process leading to arthritis and tendonitis can actually be stopped and even reversed through proper nutrition, supplements, and herbs. So I'm going to go through some of the really critical ones here of what you can do, eat, and take to help improve and maintain your joint health.
Okay. Joanne, we have a question here.
Yeah.
So what was it called?
Turmeric.
Oh, turmeric, about an as in anti-inflammatory.
Turmeric is amazing. Turmeric is a spice, and turmeric is incredible for any kind of natural anti-inflammatory. You can use it for joint health, but also cardiovascular health. If you can take turmeric every day, you can actually get turmeric capsules. I pop 1 or 2 turmeric capsules myself every single day to reduce inflammation, reduce joint pain. But it's also good for cardiovascular health in your arteries. Often the inflammation associated with cardiovascular problems can be reduced by taking turmeric. So 1 or 2 capsules a day or a teaspoon, put it in your curries, put it in your stew, put it in your soups. It is amazing for reducing inflammation. So absolutely. If you love turmeric, then eat it to your heart's content. If you don't like the taste of it, then I suggest getting a capsule where you can just drink it and no after effect, you can't taste it. It's amazing. So yeah, absolutely.
So the suggestion here was having a little bit of chocolate afterwards if you're to kill some of the bitter flavor from the turmeric.
Yeah, as long as it's dark chocolate. If you can get dark chocolate, like 70% dark chocolate, then that's fine. That's great. Good antioxidants in the dark chocolate. Go for it.
Okay,
so here's something that might surprise some people with regards to your joint health. What's that? What's that? I missed that question. Okay. With regards to joint health, If you know that you have arthritis or you've got, you know, problems, swelling, pain in your shoulders, in your wrists, in your joints, studies show that one of the best things you can do is to eliminate nightshade vegetables in your diet. Eliminate them or reduce them. Nightshade vegetables are things like potatoes, tomatoes, eggplants, green and red peppers. Now, yes, these foods are all very good for you, but only if you have arthritis and tendonitis, a lot of swelling and pain, you might want to significantly reduce them or eliminate, because these foods contain a plant compound called solanine, which inhibits collagen repair. Okay, the reason they're called nightshade vegetables is because these foods like to grow naturally in the shade, hence the name of them. And when they've done tons of studies, it's really quite remarkable when people have a lot of arthritis pain. By reducing these foods very quickly, within a few weeks, you can really feel a difference in your body. So a lot of people who eat the Mediterranean diet, and these are really huge in the Mediterranean diet, by reducing them, you can improve your joint pain. The next thing you want to do to make sure that you're taking care of your joint health is eat lots and lots of antioxidants. Things like the dark berries, blueberries, blackberries, cherries, strawberries, raspberries, all of these foods have great antioxidants in them. And what they do is they actually slow down the progression of arthritis and joint breakdown. So, you know, whether you're making smoothies or you want to eat handfuls of these a day, a really great way to maintain your joints or prevent joint breakdown in the future. Next thing you can do to help improve your joint health is to eat lots of sulfur-rich foods. Sulfur-rich foods are the smelly ones: eggs, onions, garlic, cabbage, Brussels sprouts. Sulfur in food actually helps repair your joints. So eat lots of these types of foods. These foods are also really great for your immune system. So, I mean, the more the better. Go to town, eat lots of them. Great for your joints. The next thing you might want to do, if you know you have a lot of joint pain, is take glucosamine supplements. Glucosamine is a compound that's found naturally in the body. It's made from glucose and an amino acid called glutamine, and it's needed for the formation of cartilage and the repair of your joints. We naturally produce glucosamine, but it slows down with age, which is why when you hit, you know, your mid-30s to 40s, you start to get arthritis and joint problems, because part of the reason is your glucosamine natural production is slowed down. Okay, so glucosamine stimulates joint repair. The beautiful thing about taking glucosamine is it doesn't mask the pain like it would like an ibuprofen or an Advil, those anti-inflammatories. They mask the pain. The beautiful thing about taking a glucosamine supplement is it gets to the root of the problem. It actually helps improve pain, but more importantly, it helps repair the joint. There are no side effects with taking glucosamine supplements, which is nice. It doesn't have the same side effects as taking ibuprofen or anti-inflammatories. The only thing is it takes a while for you to see the results of glucosamine. It might take a few weeks to a few months before you start to feel the effects. And we're used to, you know, popping pills and getting immediate effects. But if you can hang in there for long-term health, it's better to be taking glucosamine 500 milligrams three times a day for at least 4 to 6 weeks before you're going to start to feel and see the differences. So this is really great. If you know you're already having joint problems, you might want to go to your health food store and get yourself some glucosamine supplements. The next thing that's so really critical for joint health are those good fats again, particularly the omega-3 fats. These are so good at reducing inflammation in your body and in your joints, and they actually help lubricate your joints. So again, 2 to 4 capsules of fish or flaxseed oil supplements a day. Eat fish a couple times, 2 to 3 times a week. Get lots of nuts and seeds, avocados in your diet. But this is truly remarkable. If you can have this every single day, good fats in your diet, Again, give it a few weeks, give it a few months, and you will see and feel the difference in your joint health. It really does reduce your joint pain. Next thing you can do to increase, maintain your joint health is to eat lots of foods like pineapple, celery, and cucumber. Pineapple is a natural anti-inflammatory. It contains enzymes called bromelain, which actually help reduce swelling and pain in your system. So you know what? Make a pineapple smoothie a couple times a week and get that pineapple into your system. Again, it's amazing the difference how quickly this stuff can help. Eating things like celery and cucumber are really great because they contain something called silica, which helps joint repair. Silica is a mineral, and basically it helps build the cartilage and connective tissue that make up our joints. So again, you could make smoothies out of celery and cucumber. You don't want to sit there and chew it, drink it. I drink a lot of my nutrients 2 or 3 times a day, make a smoothie, it fills you up, it's really healthy, and you're getting lots of really great nutrients very quickly absorbed into your system. The next thing you can do, if you have some joint problems, is think about drinking things like astragalus, licorice root, or echinacea tea. These are all natural anti-inflammatories. If you can drink any or all, mix these teas up 2 to 3 times a day. If you have some joint problems now, again, it will really help reduce that inflammation in your system, help reduce that pain. And lastly, if you're looking at maybe at some herbs that you can buy in your natural health food store, things like horsetail or nettle can help reduce swelling. You can get these in supplements, and they'll help build the joint, but also reduce the swelling. And that's it. That's it for your joint health. So there's a lot of information there, guys. I hope this has been helpful.